The work of Durham's Emergency Communications Center, better known as 911, is critical. How quickly a call is answered, as well as the information the caller provides, can mean the difference between life and death. It's a heavy responsibility that the staff at the center take very seriously, which is why they want you to know what they're doing every day to ensure that Durham is a safe and secure community. Welcome to City Life. I'm Beverly Thompson. Joining me to talk about the work of the Emergency Communications Center is Director Randy Beeman and Assistant Director Tangela Walker. Welcome to you both, and thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you for having us.
So, Randy, let's start with you. Okay, the very basics. Most people know to call 911 when there's an emergency, but like me, from a long time ago, they may not know where the call actually goes to. So tell me, what is the role of the Emergency Communications Center?
So, you know, we're so fortunate here in Durham to have a wonderful state-of-the-art communications center. Mm-hmm. And when folks call and they dial 911 using their, you know, now these days, very few landlines or cell phones or various other devices that they may have, when that emergency comes along and they dial 911, mm-hmm. then it's going to come to our Emergency Communications Center. And that's not just the city. That is all of our folks, our residents mm-hmm. that are in the county, the city, our visitors. And so it actually comes into our call center where our telecommunicators are to assist that caller. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. So, Tangela, if someone does call 911, how is that call handled? And what actually happens on the center side of things?
Initially, the most important thing that we need to process a call is location. Mm-hmm. Once we gather the location, we then ask the caller exactly what's happening, what's wrong. Mm-hmm. Once we find out those two primary questions, we then start asking the caller questions to guarantee caller safety, scene safety for our responders. While we're doing this, mm-hmm. while we're in this process, there's no responder delay simply because the call is routed during this caller questioning period. Mm-hmm. After we are done providing assistance to the caller, we then remain on the line if needed until the responders arrive, or we then hang up from the caller and proceed to answer the next call.
Okay. Why do you have to ask so many questions? I mean, you just explained that, but I know a lot of people wonder when they call into 911, they just want you to know where the emergency is and send somebody fast. But you have these questions, litany of questions that you have to ask. Emphasize again why that is so important.
Well, as Tangela just mentioned to us, it's so important. And the very first few questions, mm-hmm. you know, is where are you located? Mm-hmm. What's your phone number? Mm-hmm. What's your emergency? But then we delve into the fact of those questions, the litany of questions, the interactive interrogatories uh-huh. of whether what the problem is, what is the emergency? Mm-hmm. So as the call takers, as our staff are going through those questions, mm-hmm. from what we call within our software, we have what's called a send point, if you will. S-E-N-D, send uh-huh. point. So what that means is we have received enough information mm-hmm. that then we will send it to our dispatch unit.
Okay.
And so therefore, the call taker will still keep that caller on the line mm-hmm. asking pertinent questions. Mm-hmm. And so then we send that information to our first responders. Uh-huh. So we tone them, we page them, we set off their alarms. Mm-hmm. And then therefore, as we continue to ask the questions, we use our CAD, our computer aided dispatch.
Okay.
And so that information is then shared with the first responders. So mm-hmm. as they are moving, traveling, driving mm-hmm. towards that emergency to mm-hmm. help, to render aid, mm-hmm. as Tangela just mentioned, it's very important to get all that information because we want to make sure they get the right resources in the most efficient and timely manner.
So people don't have to worry that while you're asking and they're answering questions, that help isn't coming. You're actively sending help once you get enough information to send that help, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Now, Tangela, I know you've been a call taker before. Tell me, what is that like?
Wow. The job of a public safety telecommunicator, which is what we call mm-hmm. Everyone in this industry now, is challenging. Each caller is different. Mm-hmm. we receive calls from someone on their worst day or going through a crisis. It could be acute, but these are the calls that we receive on our normal day. For us, the goal is to provide appropriate resources, assistance, and make sure that we're getting the right responders to the right place.
That's critical.
Yes, it's very critical. Being able to fully receive and understand and sometimes translate what the call or what the information that they're providing to us is imperative to be sure that we are sending the right response to them.
You are the first responder.
We are. I call them our headset heroes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. And they truly are in a lot of cases.
Yes.
But Randy, I know it's no secret that you all have been experiencing a staffing shortage. What are some of the reasons for that? And why is it happening now?
So, you know, Bev, just as to a takeaway that Tangela mentioned just a moment ago is about that passion. But at the same time, working with people at their very worst moment ever, very likely when they call 911. And so those stress levels are extremely high. So when we're dealing with folks in the industry as the headset heroes, the true first responders, when we're dealing with the public not necessarily is on their best behavior. They're highly stressed, high anxiety. There's a lot of anger and frustration. And a lot of times, The first point of contact is that telecommunicator. And so what's happening in our industry is, and we really look deeply and we continue to reinforce good mental health for our folks because it comes to you regularly and frequently and often, all those descriptors, because we are a very high volume center, call center. We handle 700 to 1,000 calls in a 24-hour period. And that's 911 calls. And so the staffing levels, they get it repetitively, one call behind another call. Sometimes they are what we call back-to-back calls. So you don't have that time to truly decompress in some of those serious, very high-energy type calls. So then what happens is, without good mental health, then you have other issues that start to develop in an employee's life. And then we also look at from the aspect that because of a work-life balance situation. So with staffing levels are reduced, then you have people that are coming in and working more hours, overtime hours, mandatory overtime hours. And so then that work-life balance starts to wane, if you will, starts to disappear. They can't find... They're looking for a balance. And so after a period of time, then they will seek or look for other type of employment. They realize sometimes we'll have people say, you know, I thought this job was for me, but it's not. And I appreciate all the opportunities that, you know, the city has afforded them while they were here with us. And then the work hours are another thing where, in this industry, is public safety, like most all public safety folk that are in the business, you will miss holidays. You will miss those special family times and moments. You'll miss birthdays. You may miss certain ball games of your children. Very important events in a person's life. There are sacrifices. So what we're talking about is sacrifice. And along with sacrifice, there's commitment. And so we try to, and Tangela is really working to help find that work-life balance and remind people, we both do, good mental health is so important. But the industry as a whole, it is a unique individual that can really understand the importance of the job they do every day.
And so it's not hard to find that person, I guess, but the training that they receive is so critical to actually working with the public and other staff. But I guess you can understand, though, that a lot of people have worries about the staffing. You know, it's been a huge issue for the public. You know, are we adequately staffed? What do low staffing levels actually mean for your ability to answer calls?
Currently, our staffing levels is roughly, we have 69% of vacancies filled. As a resident of Durham, myself, I will not negate that there, yes, there may be some concern. But I will say we're in a different position to where we have placed mechanisms in place that were better than before, to where we can better manage our staff, better leverage our team members, their skill sets. We can diversify our team members and what they're able to do. So I think that that's given us an average, an added plus, a step up to be able to really help and build our capabilities as we continue to work on filling our staffing.
So people shouldn't be worried about the vacancy rate.
Oh, no. Our performance levels are increasing. They are certainly not where we want them to be. But with Tangela and myself and our administrative staff and all of the folks in the call center working collaboratively together, we're doing well. But we have room to grow and to improve. We certainly do.
Okay. So Tangela, to help give our audience some perspective, what is the goal to answer calls quickly? I mean, what is the industry standard?
So the national best practice standards is 90% of our calls within 15 seconds, 95% within 20 seconds. The state of North Carolina 911 board recommends all of our calls, well, 90% of our calls be answered within 10 seconds. So that's the goal that we're ultimately striving for.
Okay. And so Randy, I know I've talked to you about this before. These shortages are not unique to Durham. It's an industry-wide challenge right now. Talk to me about that.
We continue to monitor many of our agencies, our partner agencies in North Carolina. And I'm not saying that we are measuring against those other agencies or that are performing similarly like we do, but it is a national, local, state, national concern as to the continuum shortage of telecommunicators. As we spoke earlier, when you think about the high call volumes, the stresses, mental health, and also that work-life balance that is so important to people. And so all those combined, and we use a lot of technology. And so with that, people sometimes become a little stressed over the sheer volume and the amount of technology that we use. But the shortage is inherent currently in the industry.
So Tangela, does that make it difficult rather to recruit call takers? I mean, what's rewarding about the job?
Well, actually, I'll start with a reward first.
Okay.
It's rewarding because we're able to provide assistance to someone that may be in need. We're also able to provide assistance to our responders, to our public safety partners, to our brothers and sisters. The recruitment piece for us for entry-level positions is actually not that hard. The trouble where we find the most is recruiting for upper-level, more experienced positions. Also, once we get them past the recruitment phase, we find some of our challenges to be having them to successfully complete the pre-screening process. And also, once they make it into our training program, sometimes there's difficulty with having a candidate to be successful with completing the training and receiving the certifications that we are required to have. And yes, we are required to have certifications, especially in the state of North Carolina.
So that makes it tough for some applicants, but it is, they can do it.
Absolutely.
If you pick them, they have the propensity to do it.
Absolutely.
Right? So that's good. And so Randy, just thinking of the entire staffing shortage, but especially for Durham, what are you doing to actually address this shortage? I mean, are you offering incentives? Are you?
So we are, I call it, we've taken the rooftop off of the house.
Okay.
And we have thoroughly investigated all of our processes. Uh-huh. We've looked at how we're doing our selection. How are we doing our recruitment? Are we streamlining our processes as we want them to be, as mm-hmm. they should be, that mm-hmm. we are making sure that we have cast the net as broadly as we can uh-huh. to make sure that we are looking for all candidates. It's a great opportunity for folk who are 18 years of age, high school diploma or GED, mm-hmm. and 6 months of community service. And it's a great opportunity for starting a long public service career.
Rewarding.
Now, what we're also doing is to help in supporting our staffing shortages is we're involving administrative staff mm-hmm. to also participate in work schedules mm-hmm. and to help support those shifts and mm-hmm. those folks that are in the call center. Mm-hmm. We've also incentivized when we're out recruiting. So we're looking for folks from other jurisdictions mm-hmm. and we will incentivize them to come be with us, to come home to the family and uh-huh. participate with us here at Durham Emergency Communications mm-hmm. Center. We also have incentivized and helped promote internally. We want to uh-huh. make sure that there's a career progression, that mm-hmm. people have the opportunity to grow within our organization. And we put money there for them to incentivize them to move forward in the organization. There's so many opportunities for growth. Mm-hmm. You come in as a call taker. You can go in different pathways mm-hmm. from a comm officer. And what does that mean? That means that you take it from answering the call, which is very important, to also dispatching the call mm-hmm. and working with our first responders mm-hmm. as you're dispatching them. And then you get into administrative opportunities. Mm-hmm. So we've also done that. The other thing that we've done is we have expanded our what we call our training academies. And what I mean by expanding them is mm-hmm. we do about 4 a year, and mm-hmm. we started out at a small group level, and now we have enhanced that thanks to Tangela and team, because she's directly involved in the divisions of operation and also overseeing uh-huh. training. Mm-hmm. So we've gone from, we've enhanced that, we've grown it. So now okay. we're doing about 12 uh-huh. Candidates per academy. Mm-hmm. So that's also helping in the pipeline or the workflow of bringing in these folks to help with our staffing mm-hmm. issues. Mm-hmm. And also we've expanded in how we do training and processes. Uh-huh. And then what we did recently, it's been almost a year ago, it's getting close, mm-hmm. we partnered and we worked with Durham Technical Community College. Mm-hmm. And so they have a program. We actually attended their first graduation mm-hmm. and we also did recruitment there okay. Of interested uh-huh. folks. And what that does is it gives the opportunity for folks who may not really know, well, will I fit? Is this right for me? Is this mm-hmm. the right fit? Mm-hmm. And so with going through that training at Durham Technical Community College, uh-huh. that gives them a taste or a flavor of, you know, this might be in for me. Mm-hmm. And then we will recruit them, and then we move them through our training processes. And
tell me what that training process time-wise is like. I mean, from start to recruitment to actually getting on the floor.
So, you know, Beverly, because I do know it, but I want to make sure we get it right. I okay. want to ask Tangela if she will respond.
That's
since
fine.
She
mm-hmm.
she works with the training division directly uh-huh. and she smiles at me every time uh-huh. because we're going to get it right.
Okay. All right. So DECC's internal training academy is 12 weeks.
12 weeks.
We recently expanded from 10 weeks to 12.
Okay.
So that's 6 weeks in a classroom, 6 weeks on the job training. Uh-huh. So roughly from beginning, for a beginning applicant, just submitting their information, mm-hmm. That process can last maybe a month, okay. month and a half. Then uh-huh. they'll start the training process. So uh-huh. from beginning until full of release on the floor, our goal is to have them done within 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
That's okay. the goal.
All right. Okay. Yes. So if someone needs more training, you can do that too.
Yes, we do have. Yes, we do offer remedial training because uh-huh. we want all of our team members to be fully efficient, fully operable, to act fully, to work fully in their roles.
Mm-hmm. So do you think you're making progress in recruiting?
Absolutely. And staffing? We are. Okay. Yes, we are.
Good. Given the incentives and everything else you're doing. Huh?
Yes.
So Randy, I know that you guys were recently reaccredited and that you're the first 911 center in the world to hold accreditations in emergency police dispatch and emergency medical dispatch. What do these accreditations really mean, and are they important for the public to know about?
They are hugely important to the public that we serve, uh-huh. and also hugely important to our folks, our team, our workers in the center. And here's uh-huh. why. So from the perspective of being the first in the world uh-huh. to have these two accreditations, it ensures that we are consistent in managing that call, meaning that all of our folks through the training, through these accreditation standards mm-hmm. that, and we follow those very closely. We review the calls that our staff are taking, uh-huh. but that is to maintain that high level of consistency when managing the calls that come in for emergencies. Mm-hmm. And we're what's called an accredited center of excellence.
Okay.
The acronym is ACE. So we're an ACE center, mm-hmm. accredited, you know, a center of excellence. And we pride ourselves in that because also in the industry from professional development, that speaks loudly and proudly when you see that. And it's, and that's a pride as well as a tremendous asset when we have highly skilled, trained individuals mm-hmm. that are able to maintain those standards mm-hmm. when working with our callers on a daily basis.
Uh-huh.
And from that, we find that with those skill sets, our folks not only are just taking the call, but they're helping that person in how do you control bleeding?
Mm-hmm.
How do you provide respiratory assist? How do you do CPR?
Mm-hmm.
And many other aspects. That's just the medical side, the police side, and how we tell people how mm-hmm. to make yourself, keep yourself safe
mm-hmm.
if they're in a very tenuous situation mm-hmm. in a lot of danger or the potential for danger.
Mm-hmm.
So, and also with fires. So we touch many areas of emergencies. It's simply not just taking that call, mm-hmm. but it's really assisting mm-hmm. that caller, mm-hmm. Resident, visitor here in Durham.
Seems like a pretty complicated kind of job. So with that, Tangela, tell me, what are the personality traits or characteristics that you look for in a great call taker? I mean, what do you have to be really good at it?
First, patience. Patience. You may not be able to get exactly what you need at the very beginning of a call. You have to be empathetic. You have to be able to put yourselves in that person's shoes.
Uh-huh.
You have to have critical thinking skills. Although we use a protocol, you have to be able to think yourself through situations. You have to be high functioning. We work in a fast-paced environment.
Uh-huh.
You have to be able to multitask and do several things maybe at one time.
Mm-hmm.
I also say you have to be personally accountable. You have to have respect for yourself and others,
uh-huh.
mainly your teammates and your callers.
Uh-huh.
You have to have integrity. You have to be dependable. You have to show up. You have to be disciplined.
Uh-huh.
What we do is not easy.
Right.
I tell people, you know, this is not your average inbound customer service center.
Uh-huh.
What we do is completely different. It's very involved. It's very detailed. You have to be detailed oriented.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be able to listen for context clues.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's not necessarily what you hear, it's what you don't hear.
Uh-huh.
You have to believe in excellence. That's what we're striving for. You have to be able to hold yourself to a higher standard.
Mm-hmm.
And from that, that's that key word, excellence.
Uh-huh. Okay, that's a pretty high bar. But I mean, apparently we have a lot of great people who are achieving that high bar. And we know that there are others out there who can do it as well. And we
Absolutely.
Advise them to apply. Yes. So how can anybody who's interested in a career in 911 learn more about how to become involved? How to apply for the job.
So, you know, we used to be called the unseen heroes. Mm-hmm. Now we're very visible. For someone that's interested in our industry, I'm a researcher. I believe in research. Do your research. They can go on YouTube, Google. There's so many different venues, different mm-hmm. avenues that they can research what we do. Mm-hmm. Don't necessarily believe your TV shows. It's not glamorous. It's not glamorous. But I encourage those to actually apply with us. Uh-huh. Once you apply, please call us and say, hey, this is what I'm interested in. Mm-hmm. This is what I would like to do. Let's see if we can accommodate that. Mm-hmm. Would you like a visit? Ask questions. Myself, my team members, we're always available to ask questions. Wow, but mainly, wonderful. Always research the industry that you want to go into. Mm-hmm. There's so many levels, so much information available now.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, Randy, if someone's interested in learning more about the center in general, what do they need to do?
So they need to go to our website. It's a very easy website to go to. Is durhamnc.gov/, and we have a number here, 435. So that is durhamnc.gov/435. In that area, you will find a lot about our department. We also are very transparent. We uh-huh. provide our stats, our statistics yeah. of the number of calls, how many, what our staffing levels are, and our performance standards. Mm-hmm. But it also gives you a window into, well, what's Durham Emergency Communications about in the right. department and a part of the whole of the city of Durham.
Mm-hmm. That's a great first step into learning more about the center. And then call that lady, okay? Because
exactly.
she can tell you all about it. Is there anything else either of you would like to add?
Ladies first.
Well, we answer your call. Uh-huh. Always remain on the line. We always remain on the line.
Not hang up.
Do not hang up. Remain on the line. We will get to you as soon as we can. Your emergency is of utmost importance to us. Your emergency is no less important than anyone else's. Mm-hmm. So always remember that your call is important to us. Please mm-hmm. do not hang up. Mm-hmm. There is someone that's gonna take your call, mm-hmm. that will take your call.
Okay.
Just remain on the line.
Uh-huh. Okay, Randy?
And I would like to add to, additionally, a comment. So sometimes in the motoring public today, there's probably no one that doesn't have access or has a cell phone. And so when you're traveling the highways and you may come up against or upon a wreck, or you may see a house fire, there's some emergency event. Mm-hmm. The tendency, and I'm not saying do not call 911,
right.
but when we're saying don't hang up, in a very short period of time, we can receive 50, 60, 100 calls within 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the callers become frustrated, and it's the natural tendency mm-hmm. of the public. Number one is we want people to call 911.
Right.
We do want them to not hang up, but at the same time, the mindfulness that many others, and sometimes you can just look around you if you're stuck in traffic mm-hmm. and you will see people with their cell phones out, and
right.
very likely they've dialed 911 as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so we will process the calls as quickly and efficiently as possible. Mm-hmm. But those are when we have what's called high volume call periods uh-huh. or a spike in our calls.
Uh-huh.
And so we just really want people to, you know, hang in there. Don't hang up.
Mm-hmm.
And we do want you to call.
Okay.
And I always like to think when people are still listening and they're going, gosh, you know, don't I apply? Surely, you know, investigate. And the other thing is, you may have young children, young men and women that are a little bit lost right now in what their career is, and no better wonderful opportunity to serve the public, to mm-hmm. serve your family, is to get involved, come see us, come online, apply, and be a part of the family of Durham Emergency Communications Center.
All right, well said. Thank you both so much for your time. I really appreciate it. So that does it for City Life. Don't forget to follow us on social media, watch us on Durham Television Network and on YouTube, and you can listen to our podcast on iTunes. I'm Beverly Thompson. Thank you for joining me to learn more about City Life in Durham.